Hello there, welcome to liveprog, to a something new on liveprog. Welcome to the guest list. This is going to be something new I'm going to do on liveprog, where I'm going to introduce a lot of great musicians to you. And the first one is sitting here right next to me. Christiaan Bruin, but I may call him Chris.
You may call me Chris, yes.
Thank you very much. The introduction, I think I have to just mention a few names and everybody will know it. But of course, Sky Architect, Adaya, Myra Orchestra, Nine Stones Close, and his solo projects. Did I miss out anything?
No.
I got that. All right. So that is where you can know Chris from. And he's here now. Welcome.
Thank you, Marcel.
Thanks. Thank you for coming over to LiveProc HQ.
It's an honor to be the first one on the guest list.
You are the first one, definitely, yes. Yeah. The reason is very simple. I've been looking at what you're doing at the moment, and I think you are at this moment the hardest working man in Prague.
Well, I'm not sure about that, but you can say I've been working very hard, that's true. The last couple of years, actually. And it's in this year, in 2013, that somehow everything came together. And there were a lot of releases coming out. And I can imagine that from the outside, it's like, what? Where does it come from? to be honest, there's a lot of time working towards a result, actually. So it has been last couple of years, actually, really busy. Lots of project and writing and
because you have at this moment, if I counted correctly, 4 albums out. The Sky Architect album, Myra Orchestra, and your solo album
in one year. I said it's 1 year, everything suddenly comes together.
Well, where do you find the time for everything?
Well, it's everywhere. Actually, you just have to know where to look, maybe.
Okay.
because, for instance, when I was on the way to here, I'm always thinking about music or trying ideas when I have the time. When I'm traveling, writing some lyrics. So it's more like that. It's spread in really small bits, and you have to grasp all those bits and then combine them together. It's lots of time, actually, but I'm not really waiting for the perfect opportunity to do something, but there's always something else that you got in the back of your mind. I got to do this, I have to do this, so I'm not waiting for anything. And just, it also has to do with sacrificing lots of sleep as well. But yeah, I have to say, it's maybe from the outside it looks like I'm working much harder than everybody else, but I think it's much more, it's a bit different, because lots of stuff that I'm doing, it's solo projects, so I can work on my own, and then suddenly you're working really fast, because you're making lots of decisions all the time, and when you're in a band or a project with other people, then you send an email and you have to wait a couple of hours to get the response, or you call somebody and then you gotta call somebody else and you arrange a rehearsal, and then finally after 1 week you can play the bit of music that you've been composing. So, and now it's, for me, it's much more efficient, actually. But
okay,
sometimes it's a positive thing. Sometimes you really could use help of other people, or not only help, but also an opinion from outside. That somebody is saying, the stuff you're doing now is shit. just get rid of it and try something else. And when you're alone, it sometimes takes a long time to come to the conclusion that you have to go another direction.
But you're making good use of the time that you have.
For instance, I don't watch too much television. I don't have a television.
Okay.
This is really...
That's a huge time saver.
Yeah, and stuff like that. Don't get too many distractions.
Yeah.
That really helps.
Okay, so we're going to take off my questions about TV then, all right? We won't talk about that now. We'll just talk about music. You are still a young musician?
Yes.
Well, at what age did you start making music? Do you remember?
Seven years.
Okay.
And then I took snare drum lessons at the local brass band.
Yeah.
And I was seven, and they said, well, actually, normally we only take people that are older than 8. Or 8 years or older. And
yeah.
I was seven. I want to go on drum lessons. So, okay, you're seven, but we'll take you anyway. So I was seven, and I had, at that time, I didn't have a drum at all.
Yeah.
So we were always playing on the table with sticks.
Yeah.
And after a couple of months, I got my first snare drum. And after a couple of more years of... I had just snare drum lessons.
Yeah.
And then I was in the marching band with the snare drum. At the same time, I also played some recorder. Recorder.
Yeah.
Actually, my mother taught children to play the recorder at the school, and then suddenly I played recorder as well. And then I was about 12 years, and I got my first real drum kit lessons.
Yeah.
And it was, well, really a big difference, because it's lots of other types of music suddenly. Because before that I was just playing marching music and stuff like that. And suddenly you can play along with all the songs from the radio and stuff like that. So, and then I got really interested in, I think, pop and rock music in general. So I was then 14, and I had my, I think 13, 14, I had my own guitar.
Mm-hmm.
Which wasn't actually my own guitar. It was from my parents, but it felt like my own guitar.
Yeah.
And then I started fooling around with it. Actually, I didn't really have proper guitar lessons. Just fooling around and trying stuff, and sounded like shit. And then I started my own band, and actually from there I just never stopped. So I was already very much in the beginning. I could play like guitar and drums, who are very important instruments. So as soon as I knew how to record stuff, then it was suddenly became very easy to make a song on my own, because when you can when you play guitar, everybody who plays guitar at least thinks they can play bass guitar as well. I mean, bassist will definitely say otherwise, but at least every guitarist thinks he can play a bit of bass as well.
Yeah.
So I also pretended to be a bass player and some keyboards as well, but it were mostly very easy, like string sound. So I only had to try some chords, and so I'm not really pianist or anything.
Yeah.
So that was my during a long school period with lots of bands and lots of bands that didn't make it as well. And then I more or less got the idea of doing more stuff on my own, because there were lots of people with different styles of music that they liked. So there were not so many people who liked the more symphonic, progressive, strange music.
Yeah.
So so more or less I was forced to do more on my own.
Yeah.
And the thing is, with multi-track recording, it's very easy, because you can do everything one by one. So you can add stuff. Actually, it was even before I had a computer to work with. I had a tape recorder, not the big one, but a little. And somehow like there was something wrong with it, because it has a record function, of course. And
when
you record, it also erases.
Yeah.
But except for the fact that mine didn't really erase, so I found out that there was in the background always the thing that you have done before.
Yeah.
So once I noticed that, I noticed I can do lots of stuff on top of each other.
Yeah.
And of course, you cannot mix it, so it sounds like shit. But it was my first try, and then I had lots of other crazy experiments with mini disc players as well, and recorders.
Yeah.
And then I finally got myself a proper computer with Cubase and stuff, and it's like a new world. Ah, shit, I can
imagine all this stuff.
And there's so many possibilities suddenly, and you can, you get addicted to this process of of working and tweaking and,
yeah,
and adjusting. So, and then, so I was making my own songs, and then I had, somebody had to sing actually, and nobody that I knew wanted to do sing. So then I have to sing as well. And in the beginning, I didn't really like my voice, actually. So it took me a while to get a certain technique for it, maybe. And maybe that's also the reason why that I, in the beginning, I used to record lots of vocal layers and more choirs. And so it doesn't sound so much like me, but just more like some random guy singing lots of vocals. So that was actually how I began. And like I said, when you're doing all this stuff on your own like this, you can work really fast as well.
Yeah.
And this is maybe also the reason why that I've done so much.
Okay. Did you take any singing lessons to, you know, become a better singer, or just you left it at that?
No. I just experimented lots of it. I actually don't know why, but especially between the first CD and second CD, it really sounds like a different guy is singing, but basically it's just me. And something in between, so I don't know what happened, but somehow it already sounds so much different.
Yeah.
And from there on, the differences got a bit smaller. But in the beginning, it's like used to hearing your own voice and sounds like shit. And suddenly the other days, well, this is also my voice. And somewhere, well, if I sing like this, it's much more. So you got to find your voice, maybe.
Yeah. Okay.
I still always a bit searching. I don't really consider myself to be a brilliant lead singer as well. But I really like it. In the beginning, I didn't really like singing at all. But now, somehow it feels so very much personal when you have your own music with your own voice. It's really different than with your own music and somebody else's voice. And that's,
now you already mentioned a little bit the whole symphonic progressive thing, because when you were young, did you got in touch with certain kind of music that made you want to make music? Or because it's an interesting choice that you went for a snare drum at a young age already.
Well, that the beginning was just my brother was playing snare drum, and I thought, oh, I have to play snare drum.
So the family.
He's playing snare. I want snare drum as well. So then I had to, and actually, I wasn't really thinking about making music on my own. It was just playing music was much more the initial idea, actually.
Yeah.
And to be honest, I wasn't really aware of much pop or rock music until much later, actually, because at home we didn't play any stuff like Pink Floyd or Beatles.
Yeah.
We didn't have any of that. It was only a bit classical and classical music. I never got the idea of making my own music until I got a guitar, actually, and then on guitar it was just way more fun to do your own stuff than to study somebody else's song.
Yeah.
I never had the patience to figure out the notes of another song. It was much more interesting to me to see, oh, if I do this note and this note, I get a different texture than if I do this note. And then you start, so it's like backwards discovering chords and scales, actually, because I didn't know about scales at all.
Yeah.
And didn't know about chords either, but I just knew, if I go to this fret and this fret, it will sound like this. And if I do that one, will sound ugly. So I don't do that.
Yeah.
No. So it was really, really intuition, actually.
Okay. So you taught yourself basically everything to play.
Yeah. And it was, no theory, actually.
Yeah.
It was really later than when I wanted to do conservatory.
Yeah.
My sister was doing conservatory as well. And she said, well, if you're going to do that, you got to do theory as well. And you got to read notes and everything.
Yeah.
And I was like, shit, I got to learn all this stuff. So I spent, I started to spend some time on figuring out major scales, minor scales, and major chords, minor chords, and all this stuff. And then I had an exam for the conservatory, and they were going to decide whether they would allow me to study on them.
Okay.
And afterwards, they told me that my music theory was the best of all my abilities. Okay. And for me, it felt like different because I never had learned it in that way. So it felt like something from the outset that didn't connect with how I was listening to music.
Okay. And
so I was really surprised that they that it was good enough.
Yeah, okay.
But I must say, I'm still really bad in reading scores.
Yeah.
And always have to read it twice before I get it. But I'm not... I can do it, but read it not so fast. So.
But you do need it in your music at the moment.
Well, I didn't until I decided to have guest musicians as well.
Okay.
And then if you have a classical guest musician, you cannot just say, oh, just play ABC at the chorus and you'll be fine. No, you have to really write what you want, because there's lots of stuff that you take for granted as a musician. Mm-hmm. So stuff like dynamics or interpretation.
Yeah.
When somebody else is playing your music, you really have to instruct them how to play it.
Yeah.
Because Well, you cannot expect them to play what you have in your head, because how can they know what you have? So then I have to learn how to write a proper score.
Based on your last solo album, where you had indeed a couple of all classical musicians guesting, it sounded fantastic. So I think it went well.
That's good to hear. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I must also credit the musicians for that, I think, because there are lots of stuff, especially with, for instance, violin or cello, there's lots of parts that I write, and I just think, well, it would be great if they would play this part, and then they tell me, well, this is actually not how you would normally write for cello, for instance.
Okay.
But I'll try it anyway, and somehow they always manage to play the stuff anyway. So I have to really give them credit as well for that being open as well, because it's really different. It's not classical music at all, I think.
That's
so
true.
So it's really, as a classical musician, you have to be more open for this type of music. And so I'm really, really happy with it, that they managed to really take it to another level, actually.
Yeah, okay. Now you are, of course, heavily involved in progressive rock, but did you discover that on your own, or was there someone that showed you or played you some of that music?
Well, I had when I was small, like I said, we only had classical LPs, but there was suddenly one LP which was Trace, which is from Rick van der Linde, which is also Exception and stuff, the drummer from Focus. So I really liked that one, but I didn't know at all that this was symphonic progressive music or anything. I just liked the music. I didn't know anything about it, actually, till I was in a metal band, which I started when I was 14, and then we went recording demo CD at that was a Night Area studio from Gerben Plaatsinga.
Okay.
In Boskoop, this is where I lived as well.
Yeah.
And during this recording, he showed me bits of, old Genesis and IQ, I think it was, and Camel as well. And then I went home and I was on the internet searching all this stuff, and suddenly found there's this whole world of bands you never heard about before. And so I have a lot of catching up to do.
Yeah.
Because even, for instance, Pink Floyd or Beatles, and I didn't really knew it until I was maybe 17 or something.
Okay.
So it was like, there's this whole thing I never heard about, and then you suddenly discover this.
Yeah.
And then there's turns out to be lots of it as well. So this was really like intensive listening music. And I think in this period I've also listened, I haven't been listening so much music since then I was in this period.
Yeah.
Now I don't really manage to hear anything. everything that's new. I don't really know about it. But from that time, I knew everything. And you get really curious about everything. And you read the album notes. And, this guy is playing on this as well. And then you see the connections. And oh, you know how this thing really started.
I know. Connections on your music as well. Names that you find on different albums, for example, because, Ruben van Kruisten.
And this is also a guy who I've been playing for since I was 15, playing with, actually. And then I was playing with him in a band called Arcania, and this was a symphonic metal band which he started, actually. And I was playing in another band, and we were a bit like the two metal bands of the school, like Kenya and then you had my crappy band, and so they asked me to play bass, and of course being a guitarist I was thinking I can play bass. And so I did play bass. This was also a bit more already much more in the direction of symphonic music as well, because I was playing with my band, it was like melodic death metal or something. And then when he was playing already metal with cello and stuff and keyboards as well, so it was much more symphonic already. And then maybe a bit from there I was also going in that direction. So you have also, you have always that when something emerges, it doesn't come from nothing. There's always,
that's true,
different lines leading in this direction. So that's something I really am interested in about other musicians as well. So it's really different. Nice to see when you have a particular album of a band, it really fits in the period in which it has been written.
For example,
suddenly you discover the influence that a certain band has on another band.
Yeah.
And or backwards. So this is really interesting because nobody is inventing the wheel on its own. Everybody is listening and being absolutely influenced.
I mean, have you ever discovered that someone found you an inspiration for their music?
No.
I have,
but it was not actually my solo music, but I have read some guy saying that they really had Sky Architect, for instance, as an influence. And this was really strange because we had our first album, it was one CD, and we were not even sure of what we were doing at all.
I mean,
it's like we have these random songs and just record them, and suddenly there's somebody else on the other side of the world who is being influenced by our crazy ideas, and this is really strange.
Yeah,
and this all thanks to the internet, I suppose.
It's a great force, which helps, of course, a lot to make your music heard and your band known to a lot of people in a very short time.
Yeah, people are always complaining about they're downloading our stuff. I mean, it is true, people are, but on the other end, there are lots of people discovering your music. And especially when you're in progressive music, there seems to be only in the Netherlands, for instance, it's a relatively small group of people who are interested, and suddenly worldwide it seems to be this huge network.
That's
and
true,
actually it's a lot of people actually who are still interested and really devoted to music, actually. So I wouldn't know how they would ever have heard from about Scar Architect without the internet. I think maybe my neighbor would have, but
It would have been by chance. I mean, well, of course, you had magazines back in the day. I mean, I remember.
That's true, but somehow it's still much more. It's very easy to get your stuff out and to have listeners. Well, it is still a bit difficult to get to the right audience.
Yeah.
Still, but if you just say, well, it's this and this kind of music, people will find you anyway, because there's always somebody searching the internet for bands like this or bands like that. I think you also have this Last FM stuff as well, where you instantly get this. If you like this, then you also like this.
Yeah.
And this really works, because it's also that these bands are really connected. Mm-hmm. Maybe as a musician, you're not really aware of it. You think, I have my own music. It's, I mean, I'm an individual, but... you're never really an individual. I mean, you always have connections.
Yeah.
And there are lots of people who said, for instance, to me about, it really sounds like Steve Hackett, for instance. They said, your music sounds like Steve Hackett. And then I said, no. I mean, I have heard Steve Hackett, but I wasn't thinking of Steve Hackett when I was writing. Yeah. I was just writing music, but... when you look at it afterwards, it really makes sense, for instance, because this was in a period that I had listened to. Maybe not particularly Steve Hackett, but at least the old Genesis stuff, which is a part of
very much Hackett.
So there was lots of connection, but you don't really realize this all the time. This reminds me of the idea of being individual and to have nothing to do with somebody else. It reminds me of this scene of Monty Python scene, where you have all these people, I think it's Life of Brian, and he's saying, you are all individuals, and then you have this crowd of people,
we are all
individuals, and suddenly someone said, no, I'm not. This is really...
Yeah, I know, that's best. A great scene. Yeah, he tries to make them think on their own, and... they just mindlessly repeat after him, which is a lot of fun.
We are all in the bit,
Yeah, you just said, you know, at this moment you don't really have time to listen to music, because, well, you're amazingly busy making music yourself.
Yeah,
but
that's true.
Back in the time that you did have the time to listen to music, what did you find any particular albums that really inspired you or really gave you a sort of a push? You know, I want to also make that kind of music.
Yeah, Foxtrot of Genesis was really one of those, which really got me into this longer song structures, where you have a bit of longer attention span, long build up towards a climax, for instance. And this is something I really liked, as well as it was really theatrical as well. Mm-hmm. Lots of drama and voices, strange voices.
Yeah.
There are lots of things about that album that drumming also. The drumming is really cool. And the keyboard sounds as well. It's all classic stuff. And also, we just mentioned IQ, and there was this album, Seventh House. This was also somehow really connected with me as well, because it was really... mysterious mood and a bit melancholic as well, and also more really a nice balance between, I think, a complex structure, but somehow it retains lots of accessibility as well.
That's true.
So it never gets too technical or too complex to be on an emotional level as well. So those two are... when you talk about progressive music, it's really important albums for... well, it is at least then.
Yeah. But are you keeping up a little bit with what's going on?
Yeah, I really try
these days. Or,
well, I try to, but it is... I don't know. I try to listen to some new stuff, but it tends to be not so much progressive rock actually at all.
Okay.
It's much more... I have to say, I have some favorites which I really like, and then when they have something new, I give it a listen. But apart from that, there's lots of other music actually.
Yeah.
Much more outside prog actually than inside. For instance, now I've been listening lots of movie scores.
Mm-hmm.
I really like this, because it's actually, it's most of the time it isn't really really complex music. It's pretty easy to grasp what's happening, but still there's lots of drama and tension as well. I really really like movie scores, but there, I know there's lots of stuff that I've been listening to, and therefore it's really difficult to keep up to date with everything because there's so much. And for instance, there's a lot of friends of mine who are also really into more extreme metal, for instance, and then they tell me, "Ah, you have to listen to this." And this some of this stuff is really compositionally wise, it's really interesting.
Yeah.
So I am interested, but if I were to listen everything that was available, there would be too much of it.
That's true. I mean, I think no one could keep up with the amount of albums.
No.
Especially, just in Prague, if you see how many albums are being released, and then I would almost say, you know, what economic crisis? I mean, look at how many albums are coming out.
And as a musician, you should never think about this, because then you get depressed, I think, if you realize with each month there's this huge pile of CDs coming out and you're just one of it, and you're working for 2 years on this project and it ends up on the bottom of this pile.
Yeah.
So,
and some reviewer gets it as one of 20 or 30 promos that he has to review.
Each month.
Each month, indeed. Yeah.
So I try not to think about the quantity that gets released every year. Still, there's lots of to discover as well. You suddenly on internet, you discover something that's really, really creative and new. But there's lots of stuff out there that sounds like something else. And I'm not really interested in everything.
No, of course. Of things are linked and connected. I discovered your music first of all through Sky Architect. That was the first music I heard. I remember that the first album, Excavations of the Mind, was praised as being, you know, fantastic. So I was curious, and of course I listened to it, and then we had the pleasure, of course, to see Sky Architect on stage. Well, I've seen twice at the Lakai in Helmond. In a relatively short period of time, you play there twice. Yes. It almost made me think, I mean, some people say that progressive rock is difficult music, but when you see Sky Architect on stage, you would almost say it is difficult music, because it is very complex music.
Well,
at least.
It's a bit, it's really relative term, what is complex.
Of course.
But it is a bit more complex in terms of, there's a lot of strange things happening.
Yeah.
I mean, there are strange time signatures and strange transitions as well.
Yeah.
To me, there's lots of music out there that's actually much more complex than I don't know. Progressive music listeners, I always tend to think of prog as being really intellectual, complex music. But to me, it isn't really like this. It's much more like the musicians being a bit more adventurous in a way, and not restraining themselves and being a bit more creative. It's really out there. For instance, well, if you compare it to, I don't know, for instance, Frank Zappa music, Sky Architect suddenly sounds like pop music to me. So I don't know. It's
all relative. Indeed.
Yeah, really.
Yeah. Thing that I was wondering about, I mean, I've been following Sky Architect ever since. I noticed that you guys often went to Sweden to work on an album. Did you do that for this album as well?
We wanted to do it, but we didn't actually, because I don't know, somehow didn't see possibilities with our time. So we didn't actually. We recorded on lots of different locations. We recorded drums and bass in Night Area Studios as well.
Yeah.
This time, again, at the same time, we decided with no click tracks, it's just playing live in the studio as much as we can at the same time.
Okay.
Guitars were also done on different locations. We did just at home with some complaining neighbors, I think. Suddenly, somehow it always sounds better when the amp is louder than it's softer. But so we did lots of stuff at home as well. So in the end, I don't really think that you will not notice it in the sound quality, but I think you do notice it in the overall atmosphere of the feeling of an album, because the than the one we did in Sweden.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just me, but when I listen it back, I'm immediately back there.
Yeah.
And it really has this, I don't know, much more quiet feel to it. It's much mm-hmm. more calm down.
Yeah.
And new one is a bit more, like Holland is anyways.
Okay. It's a bit of a science fiction theme this time.
Yes.
Well, what inspired it?
Yeah, we were really inspired by this old science fiction stuff from the 50s and the 60s yeah. and 70s. So this really crappy looking
okay.
science fiction and
the cult
not,
movies.
Yeah, not so much the Hollywood stuff, but really the older stuff, like the for instance the old Star Trek series
or yeah.
or The Day the Earth Stood Still. This, mm-hmm. these really old movies.
Yeah,
I don't know why, but somehow it really connected well with our
okay.
strange music. Afterwards, we were really surprised with how well mm-hmm. this it suited us actually.
Yeah.
So we were really thinking of, oh, let's do another science fiction album because it's really, really like a warm bath to,
yeah.
to be in. But I don't know about next album yet. But it worked out really well, I think,
yeah.
for us. As myself, I'm not really a big science fiction.
Mm-hmm.
Fan. I don't
yeah.
know so much. I don't know so much movies or science fiction literature, for instance.
Yeah.
But so maybe it's more the other guys that are really inspired by this stuff. But not only the books or the movies, it's also the idea of
yeah.
space, because this is something that's endless. I mean,
of course. Yeah.
So. And not only endless literally in space, but also endless in for imagination for
mm-hmm.
it.
Yeah.
So whatever you can imagine that might be out there, might be out there even. So,
that's true. I mean,
so and this is there's a huge potential for anything can happen
yeah.
in this space. So this is much more the idea that I like about
okay.
the science fiction theme. That's it, that is so much possibilities
yeah.
because anything can happen in this.
Yeah, you can't prove it's not happening. So
yeah. yeah, until you prove me wrong, it
yeah.
is happening.
Creating a bit of a fantasy world is often done in music, of course.
Yeah.
Creating something that you don't find on Earth. Do you see music a bit as a form of, you know, to escape the daily problems a little bit, or
sometimes, but in this case it is not only fantasy, it's also just even science can be so strange that it is almost like fantasy when
yeah,
we're talking about this quantum physics, for instance. I have done several attempts to understand anything of it and I failed every time, but still there's so much in there that is so mind-blowing.
Yeah.
So, and this is science, this isn't even fantasy or children's books. This is
yeah.
real stuff. So even reality is can surprise you so much.
Yeah.
But so on other times, yeah, it can be much more like a fantasy. When I did the second album, Making Sense, it was
yeah.
a bit like I had this story fantasized about this guy who is about to meet his creator. And this creator is telling him all kinds of stuff, and of course this is all just me fantasizing.
Yeah.
So you can use music to escape from reality.
Yeah.
But I don't know, somehow it doesn't really feel like escaping reality. It's much more like going to another place and,
yeah.
and suddenly you look back at reality from a different perspective.
Okay.
So you keep it always comes back to reality.
Yeah.
I mean, at the end of the day, it's just you recording stuff at the computer. And,
yeah.
and I mean, you always come back to reality,
yeah.
but you try to have a really broad horizon and really try to view your reality from different perspectives.
Yeah.
And so it's much more that I find interesting than it's not so much that my life is so bad that I want to escape. No.
Yeah. But can you imagine that people want to like to listen to that kind of music, you know, to get away from, well, maybe a bad thing or a
yeah.
situation they don't like, and just, you know, like to be entertained for a while and forget everything around them, you know, and just
yeah,
go into that story that you as a musician have created.
Yeah, I can imagine that, but this is something that's been said lots about fantasy books, for instance, that some people also judge it in this way. So they say, yeah, you're escaping reality. This is it's not what you should do.
Yeah.
Again, for me, I don't read so much fantasy, but the thing I find interesting about this kind of books that it, though it is in a really different world and it's lots of, dragons and strange stuff, but there is a lot of stuff about characters that actually tell us lots about ourselves.
Yeah,
ourselves as well. So it's like, how do you say it? It's first you tell a story and then you compare it to, suddenly you compare it to your own world, and then you suddenly learn something.
Okay.
It's like you put a different light on it, or you see yourself through a strange kind of mirror, and you suddenly. For instance, this is something really different, but I am reminded. I was at an exhibition a couple of weeks ago, and this was a Da Vinci exhibition, and he had this room which was more or less round.
Yeah.
And it has mirrors all around.
Okay.
And with a result that you're seeing like infinite variations of yourself, because you're seeing suddenly yourself in all kinds of directions reflected in these mirrors. And this is really interesting because it suddenly is like, oh, so this is how I must look like for somebody else who is sitting behind me. And you never think about it.
That's true.
You never really have a clear image of what somebody else will see when they're walking behind you.
Yeah.
So, and this is a bit the same with the, with like fantasizing and how that does it relate to reality. Somehow it is, you're always come back to reality, but somehow it looks different when you come back.
Yeah.
It's a bit like going on vacation and then you go home and it's like, oh, you see it all, somehow you see it again. Yeah. There's lots of stuff you don't see. If everyday stuff, you somehow you stop to notice it.
Yeah, you take a lot of things for granted.
Yeah, and then you come back and it's like, oh yeah, and you see, suddenly you really are aware of the colors or the anything actually. So this I find really interesting, and this is something that keeps inspiring as well. So it never gets old, anyways.
No, that's true. But when you make music, do you at that point also sometimes think, you know, how would someone else hear this?
Yeah, of course. I mean, you're always. I try not to, of course. Okay. I try not to. Somewhere in the back of your head, you're thinking about this. Especially when it comes to mixing, for instance, and it's really hard to imagine what somebody else is hearing in your music. Because you as a musician, you know exactly about the layers and how the mix is put together. And about which effects did I use, for instance. Which chord do I use with what bass notes and anything. But as a listener, it's a completely different perspective. So. You always try to imagine your music from the outside instead of from the inside. But this is really this is something you can only do when you you do not listen it for a while, and then you come back to it and it suddenly is, it's new. So and suddenly you notice a lot of stuff that you didn't in the first place. But try not to think about it too much about how, I mean, because when you start thinking about how would other people listen to it, or would they like it, or what will they like about this song or this album, I mean, then you get lost.
That's true.
There's, everybody has a different opinion as well. So about the same album, reviews can go from this is the best stuff I've ever heard in my life, from this is a mediocre, don't listen to this album review. So it can be anything actually. So
do you read the reviews from your music?
Well, I don't know, sometimes I've when you're bit bored, for instance, then you get, well, maybe see if there are some in reviews about it. But again, I try not to read it too much, especially not when it's been just released, because then you're really like, you have so much affection with the thing that they're talking about, because if they were smashing it, like, this can really hurt, really. This is something that you have been working on for weeks and months, and then somebody says, yeah, it could have been better, actually. Well, it's not as good as the last one. Somehow it's a bit lax, and that. I mean, what's to say? You cannot do anything about it. It's already happened, and it's only one guy saying this, but still, he is saying it, and everybody's reading. So I try not to get too much involved in this as well.
Yeah, better focus on the nice things, on the making music. We started off with saying that you are in a lot of bands. Chronologically, in what order did these bands come up?
First one I joined was myself.
Okay.
First I joined my solo project as a guitarist, and then I joined my solo project as a... Now, first I did first Chris album. Soon after that, maybe at the same time already, In Sky Architect.
And yeah.
So these two albums are, I think, more or less at the same time. And then during time of A Dying Man's Hymn, then I started with my orchestra.
Mm-hmm.
And also, and a bit later... with Adaya as well. Okay. So it's I might be wrong, but I think Adaya came last. But also these projects are all a bit intertwined as well, because there are lots of musicians who are working with the same project.
I know. So,
for instance, violin player on my last album is also in my orchestra, for instance, and there's lots of stuff like this going on. So this is the Rotterdam scene we're talking about.
But you all met in school, right? I've seen one name that kind of links you all, Codarts.
That's true, yeah. So this is the conservatory in Rotterdam.
Yeah.
And this is more or less, this is where somehow it all comes together.
Yeah.
And so you immediately get this image of this must be the most magical place ever. But actually, it's not so much the school itself, it's much more that people you meet there. I knew Ruben, the cello player in Adaya, I knew already from previous school, actually.
Yeah.
Other than that, it's all everybody I'm working with, I met there. So yeah, this is... I'm really happy that I decided to go there.
Yeah.
Because I wouldn't imagine. I cannot really imagine what it would be like if it went the other way. If they turned me down because my music theory was shit.
Good thing you brushed up on it.
Yeah,
and
I
really
guess so. Yeah.
Made an effort for it. Otherwise, well, we would have missed out on a lot of great music. I guess.
Maybe I would have become a fantasy writer.
Yeah.
I don't know. Deep within my bones, send me shivers down my spine. Should I have been left here on my own? I hear a voice behind the wall. One
thing I did notice, although a lot of people from all these bands work together, I mean, I noticed when I was reviewing Adaya that Baba was also a part of it, and I saw Ruben on your album, and so I noticed that, but at the same time, the bands have very different kind of music. I mean, Sky Architect is what I would say more really almost classic prog rock, but Adaya is well, fairly heavy metal. And Myra is more, well, how do you describe that? More poppy maybe?
It's more symphonic pop music.
Yeah, I think if people would see clips on YouTube, they get Cirque du Soleil ideas with it.
People say it is a bit like that.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Somehow, for me, there are between each band there's a, at least one link to another band, musically speaking.
Yeah.
So I think my orchestra has a lot in common with my music in the terms of that it is really symphonic and really, I don't know, it feels a bit warm chords and stuff like that. Lots of mystery as well. On the other hand, I think there's a really link between my music and Sky Architect because of the longer song structures or the strange chords or the strange lyrics or concept album and stuff like this, more the progressive element. And in Sky Architect, I think we take it a bit further as well in terms of technicality and stuff. And for me, this also is really linked with the stuff of Adaya, which is, it is metal, but it is also a bit more technical, a bit more complex, adventurous.
Maybe. Yeah.
To me, it isn't really like they're all apart from each other. Actually, it's much more the opposite. Everything is very much connected.
Yeah.
I don't know. This is also why it keeps, for me, interesting to do all this stuff, because there's in each project there's something else that is really distinctive of this project. And this is really because if it was five times the same band, for instance, or five versions of the same music, I mean, that's, why would you do it?
That's true.
But there's no sense in it. So also, when writing music, it's, for me, it's really clear when I'm writing something whether it would suit for my orchestra or Sky Architect or my own. For me, at least in my head, there's really a distinction, but connections as well. And this is not only with different projects, but also with different CDs that I've been doing as well, because lately somebody asked me, what is your real style? Because you tend to, they say about my music that it's so different each time. How can it be the same guy who's doing it? But actually, for me, when you listen a bit on another level, so it suddenly there's a lot of similarities. And I think if I would play on the piano a song of City of Light, and I would play on the piano a song of Days of Summer Gone, it's suddenly, it's really clear that this is the same guy. But when I, on City of Light, when I use electronic drums, suddenly everybody is like, well, this is so very different, and this is this is the wrong direction to go.
Okay.
And then, and suddenly they, well, suddenly people have all kinds of opinions about that it's too different, maybe, and or that that there's no clear musical identity. But I don't know. I think there really is a connection, but you have to listen further than just, there's the electric guitar. Oh, in this album, there's no electric guitar. Yeah. I mean, this. And this is not only with my music. I think lots of bands have this.
Yeah.
I don't know, for instance, with the last Opeth album, I think there are lots of people who are complaining that there's no grunts and for instance. And I agree, it the sound is different, but for me the spirit is really much the same. I hear the same band play, or the same guy writing his music. It is not the same band, I mean, there are lots of other people, but this is the same source, I think, and I wouldn't judge them for that as well,
because
this is really natural development. And there's lots of other bands who will also have this development. When you have, for instance, there, a lot of people are judging Genesis, for instance, that the newer Genesis is too much this and too less that. And I don't know. I really do not blame them for not making 10 times the same Foxtrot.
Of course.
I would have liked it, maybe, but I mean, you cannot blame them. It's their music. I mean, it's their choice. Huh?
Yeah.
So, And there's a really, it's not like this has been a forced development, forced by the record company or anything. This is the natural development.
Yeah.
And this is something I find really interesting, this, the links between one album to another, or the overall development over a couple of years.
Yeah.
For me, it's much more interesting to see how things develop in, instead of having each time the same album with different lyrics.
that's true. Now, well, I gotta say, when I listen to, for example, your solo work, if I look at the three albums that I have and I reviewed, I hear that it is you. But at the same time, I hear three different albums. Personally, I find it a lot of fun to listen to them because of the fact that they are different.
Yeah.
And as you say, I mean, you can come up with the next album. I mean, that is a complaint that I remember hearing in progressive rock a while back. They were saying that bands like Flower Kings or IQ or even Pendragon were all making albums after album that kind of sounded the same, that you could pick out a song from one album and put him on the other and you wouldn't notice because of the same style. But I think if they would do that with your album, it wouldn't fit. You would hear that that song does not belong there. So in that way, it's nice to see a progression. But then when bands do change their style, some fans say, they're changing their style. I don't like it anymore.
I'm not a fan anymore.
Yeah, so you can never please
everyone. I'm wearing off my tattoo, yeah. you cannot please everyone.
No, that's true. That's a fact, unfortunately. But, you know, luckily there are a lot of people who are enjoying the music you make. And now we can add something else to your list. Nine Stones Close.
Yeah, it isn't really my list yet because we haven't.
Yeah, okay, but it.
But yes, this is
so far. It's only been announced that you joined the band.
But actually, behind the scenes, I've been already working quite a lot with Adrian.
Okay,
Adrian is really the mastermind of this band.
Absolutely,
he is also really productive as well. For instance, we at one time, I was. Supposed to meet him and work on some arrangement for a song, and of course I was late, and and then I got there eventually, and in the meantime he had written two songs. and then I said to him, I have to come late every time, because then we would have five as many albums if we
okay
had. But this is just to make clear, this is really the driving force, this guy. And I'm a keyboard player, so I'm arranging the sounds and working as well on some, I don't know, melodies, song structures, transitions, stuff like this. So more like the second step of composing we're doing together, but the initial these, it's all in his mind as well. And as far as I know, we have lots of songs now. There's really lots of material, and we have not only... new keyboard player, but there's also a new singer as well.
Yeah, I heard. I don't know his name, but...
This is another Adrian, and this is a guy from Ireland.
Okay.
Yeah, so this is not the most practical location, but it's a real great singer. He's really different to Mark, who was singing on the previous albums. But I mean, this guy's really powerful voice and really very big range as well, and can do lots of different types of singing. So I'm really curious to see where this will go to.
I think a lot of people will be curious. I mean, because the albums that I've heard so far from Nine Sounds Close are very atmospheric, very melancholic.
Yeah.
But you know, you've joined now, but also Peter van Hoorn from Night Area.
Yeah,
he's also joined. Now, Peter Vink.
Yeah.
I would say a bit heavier musicians.
Yes.
But will that... Do you think... That, I mean, you know, of course, a little bit more than I do, but I'm wondering the how do you say, the development of the sound. Will it change very much, or... Will it still be in recognizable as Nine Stones Close?
Both, actually.
Okay.
It's actually, it's a bit more, I think new stuff is a bit more heavy as well. I don't know, maybe a bit more Porcupine Tree influences, for instance, or a bit more heavy stuff in there. But at the same time, there's lots of atmospheric lots of it as well. Yeah. Actually, lots of, I don't know, talk influences, for instance. This is really a nice combination actually between having this really free soundscape kind of stuff, but also the electric guitar riffs as well. So it's both actually. Okay. So yeah, I'm really curious to see how the result will be, because for now we have only the demos. I think the beginning of 2014 there will be proper recordings.
Yeah.
So I cannot really tell yet what it will be, but I'm really happy with the stuff we have so far actually. And Adrian is as well really motivated to go on with this, because it's again, this is really a transition in, I think, a natural transition for the band as well, because everybody who joins somehow influences the whole trajectory of a band.
Yeah.
So Peter, for instance, is quite a heavy drummer.
Yeah.
So this really puts a mark on it. If you would have a jazz drummer, for instance, if I would play drums, for instance, I'm not the jazz drummer, but I don't know what kind of I don't know what kind of drummer I am, but at least it would be different. I mean, another way of playing, another drum kit, another sound as well. So these are all decisions as well, but they don't really feel like decisions. It just feels like cooperating with people, but this is really important actually.
That's
so
true.
We'll have to wait a bit longer, but
we'll keep an eye on that.
Yes, will be worth the wait.
Yeah. Now you said you had a couple of very busy years leading up to what we had in the last few months, a lot of albums out. You know, any normal person would say, you know, you take a break, you take a vacation, get some rest. Yeah. But what do you do? You start something new.
Yeah, this is me. Yeah,
I mean, you just announced it, the Black Codex.
Yes, this is the Black Codex. This is really another chapter.
Yeah.
to begin. Yeah. And this was in the summer of this year.
We were.
I have a brother who is living in Switzerland. Who was living in Switzerland at that time, and then we had to move him because he was moving to England.
Yeah.
And me and my other brother and another guy, we were first going to Switzerland, get his stuff, go back to England with the boat to England and back to Holland as well. So we had this really long trip where I was forced on not working, because I was just sitting in the car. And then I was thinking about new project. And most of the time when you have an idea for a new CD or a new song, most of the time the inspiration comes from like real content. So inspiration is, I really like this kind of song structure, or really this kind of concept or topic. But this time, much more the inspiration was like the whole format of how to release music. And I don't know, I really wanted to do something else than just releasing a CD again, because there are lots of limits in this way. Because, for instance, when you have one album, usually it's like that you make like some decisions and those remain for the whole album. So, for instance, I work with I don't know, this kind of drum sound, this drum kit, for instance.
Yeah.
And then it's the whole album usually is like this. So, and this is just one example. There are lots of examples when you are fixed to this CD format. At the same time, you have this development of decrease in CD sales as well.
Yes, that's...
And I was somehow, while traveling through Europe, I was thinking, I gotta do something different this time. And then I got the idea of, why not doing a series of music? So having that in mind, I really immediately liked this. And I figured, well, I have to make music every week. So this will be lots of music. And now I can still laugh about it, but next year I don't know.
We should meet next year.
Yeah,
and see how you're doing.
I will be probably lying on the couch.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I immediately liked this idea. So as soon as I got it in my head, there was no way back. It was a bit like last year I did Snow Stories, this Christmas album. And I was just lying in my bed and just thinking, well, I'm going to make a Christmas track this year, for instance. And then I thought, let's make a Christmas EP. And then I thought, well, I can also make Christmas album. And suddenly when this seed starts growing in your head, there's no way back. I'm going to do it. I have in that moment made a decision, which I have to stick to. So then at that point, I decided to do the series, and then I had not really a clue about a story or anything.
Yeah.
I'm now working on it. So I'm working on a story. I have this grand scheme of things already somewhere in my head and on my computer and all kinds of games and storylines. So yeah, this is the idea that you get, subscribe to the Black Codex, and then every week you get new music with the lyrics and illustrations and drawings and everything. And each piece of music also goes into the next one.
Okay.
So you can really listen it in one go in the end.
Okay.
So this is, it's a bit like a concept album, but just spread over 52 bits.
Yeah.
So I don't know, I really like this idea, and then I started working on it.
Yeah.
And at the same time, try to keep a bit room for spontaneity as well. Yeah. So there's lots of decisions that I haven't been making, because I don't want it to be like a struggle to get this 52. I really want it to be fun as well. So this is the thing. I really wanted to have the opportunity to get like new possibilities every week, because if I didn't really like the thing I did last week, then I get a new chance to do something.
Yeah.
This is really cool, because then it somehow also motivates to take a bit more risk in terms of music. Because, for instance, if you just know, well, this year I'm going to make one CD, then this already feels like really heavy on your decisions, because everything you do will be on the CD. And now, because there's so much music.
Yeah.
It's somehow there's a bit less pressure on individual decisions, because I can do different things on different episodes. And I really liked the idea of having this. On one hand, it's like easy to consume, like it's really bit by bit, and it isn't this huge piece of work in one go.
Yeah.
So it's feels a bit lighter to me as well. And so, but at the same time, it still has this really epic scope of a concept album. It's even bigger than that. I mean, this is more like a world where anything can happen. So this is also something that there could also be a Black Codex too, for instance. Okay. So this is, at the same time, it's more ambitious, but on the other hand, it's also a bit more, I don't know, easier to digest. I think so. I'm curious to see where it will will lead us.
It sounds very interesting and a nice challenge for you as a musician, you know, to explore your musical boundaries and I'll see if you can go past them even.
And I already have the impression that this is really challenging me as well. So there's lots of stuff that I already am doing. I am already starting to compose a bit, and I'm already doing stuff that I wouldn't be doing otherwise. And this in its own, I think is a good development, that this project encourages me to do stuff that I haven't done already. Because actually I was working on a new Chris album already. And then I pretty soon got the impression this is going just to be another one. And I don't know, this is too much of the same. So for me it's ideal, but we have to see how it will turn out.
Well, we're going to keep an eye on it. Mention the website. Where can people find information of that?
We have a website. It's www.theblackcodex.com.
Okay.
And there's already some previews, and there will be more previews, and there are different ways of subscribing to this thing, because you can also subscribe for 1 week or 2 weeks or all year. And so there's lots of stuff on the website to see about. And there will be more. There will be more previews and as soon as I have made them.
Gotta get the people curious to it. Okay, well, thank you very much for coming down to LiveProg HQ and sharing a lot of information about your musical projects with us, and of course a lot of things to come. Well, this was it then for the guest list, the first episode of the guest list with Chris, Mr. Christiaan Bruin. Hopefully there will be more episodes, just like the Black Codex. We'll have to see how it goes, but we have a start, so keep an eye on liveprog.com, where you will definitely be kept up to date on everything that's going to happen in the guest list. But we do hope to receive a lot more guests here to share their musical experiences with all of you. So stay tuned for more, and thank you for watching.